أناجي الحق في ليل لهيم أصدق النجوى، وأدعو الله من قلب سليم يطلب التقوى. أناجي الحق في ليل لهيم أصدق النجوى، وأدعو الله من قلب سليم يطلب التقوى.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أهلا وسهلا ومرحبا بكم, and welcome to another edition of Perspective. My name is Faisal Patel. In tonight's show, we look at news about Hajj as millions leave to depart for the Holy Lands. The Hawks and police are searching for a spy gadget. Carnage on South Africa and Swaziland's roads. And we also look at some tech news. Remember, you can interact with me by sending me a mail on faisal@itvnetworks.tv. Drop me a tweet on @faisy143, or you can even comment on facebook.com/faisalpatel. Now, going on to the Saudi area, to Saudi Kingdom, the Middle East, more than 200 doors of the Haram in Mecca, including the King Abdul Aziz Gate, will be thrown open to facilitate the movement of Hujjaj as the Hajj season peaks. We know in South Africa the quota is 2,500. Many has left already. Many are leaving, inshallah, in the next few days and in the coming weeks as well. Now, Abdullah Al-Tumay, the director of the Department of Doors at the Presidency of the Affairs of the Two Holy Mosques, says doors near the King Abdul Aziz Gate, which have been close to complete the third stage of the Mataf expansion project, would be open to facilitate the movement of Hujjaj on the western side of the Haram. Now, he also says that some of the closed doors would be opened from the 4th of September. So for those that are going, you'll have more access to the Haram because more doors will be open. And he also says that the rest when the work on the expansion project would be stopped for Hajj. So it makes it easier and better access to get into the Haram Sharif. Now, qualified male and female employees would man all the doors 24 hours a day to give directions to the Hujjaj, and people with special needs can use doors specifically designed for them, especially those that are traveling on wheelchairs and the elderly, and maybe even some countries that allow children maybe to go with their parents for Hajj, so it'll make it easier for them to go through these specialized doors. Now, meanwhile, the General Syndicate of Cars says it's added 700 new buses to its existing fleet, and around, listen to this, 18,000 buses will be deployed to transport Hujjaj between Jeddah, Mecca and the holy sites. So that's a lot, 18,000 buses, that's quite a bit, and it will make it easier. You don't have to wait for a long time to go from Jeddah to Mecca or to various other areas as well. Now, over 20 local transportation companies are also responsible for operating that particular buses. In other Hajj-related news, the Ministry of Health has deployed about 600 doctors, nurses and technicians at King Abdul Aziz International Airport in Jeddah to provide medical aid to arriving Hujjaj. So that's where the Hajj terminal is. When you go there, if there's some medical attention that you need, there will be more than 600 doctors at that particular airport to assist with your medical needs. And the ministry has also set up a number of clinics at the Hajj terminal, as well as the northern or in southern terminals, to vaccinate Hujjaj and provide them with emergency aid if required. Now, security officers all over the kingdom have also been given instructions to strictly monitor the movement of domestic Hujjaj from all regions of the country towards Mecca as well. Now, a Major General Saud Abdullah Al-Khalewi, Assistant Director of Public Security for Hajj and Umrah, says that the move was aimed at preventing bogus Hajj services companies from exploiting Hujjaj. We've seen it over the years, especially in that particular area, where people have been duped into spending exorbitant amounts on Hajj packages just to not realize their dream of going for Hajj. Now, several committees and subcommittees have also been formed in all cities and governorates, and surprise checkpoints will be set up at exit points on all roads leading to Mecca, and integrated security plans have been prepared to regulate Hujjaj transport and arrest violators. Now, Galewe also says the violators would face stiff penalties, including imprisonment and confiscation of vehicles used to transport the Hujaj. Now, about also, this now is a very significant move. About 700 Syrians living in Egypt will also be granted visas to perform Hajj this year. Abdul Ilah bin Khaddam Al-Faiz, the consul at Saudi Embassy in Cairo, says the embassy will work non-stop to process visas for the Syrian Hujaj. And he says the Hujaj require a return ticket. This is the requirements: a return ticket, a letter confirming accommodation in Mecca and the holy sites, and certificates of vaccination in order to obtain that particular visa. Now, about 12,000 Syrians are expected to do Hajj this year. So if you're going there, you're going to meet a number of Syrians coming from Syria, Turkey, Jordan, Lebanon and Egypt. They have sought refuge in these particular countries from the Assad regime in Syria. Now, as far as weather is concerned, weather experts are expecting current temperatures of 44 degrees. You know, when I went for Umrah and for Hajj, I mean, the temperature is just, you can't take it. It's absolutely hot. So temperatures of 44 degrees Celsius in Mecca, Medina and the holy sites to drop a little during Hajj. So there might be slight reprieve there. But I mean, 44 degrees is absolutely scorching. Now, Mahmoud Ghandoura, from the presidency of the Meteorology Department and Environment, says he expects the temperatures to drop to around 38 degrees. Not much of a difference there, if you ask me, 38 degrees during the Hajj season as well. So, and just to speak on a little bit about the heat, when you're sitting for Jummah Salah, the people are sitting there from 9 o'clock in the morning because the harams get so full. And if it's hot, it will absolutely really suffer in that heat. So for all those that are going, inshallah, may you have a pleasant journey and have a safe journey, inshallah, as well. And also remember that ITV will be there. We will be broadcasting live from Mecca and Medina and from the various other holy sites, from Mina, from Arafah. So tune in to ITV for the latest updates, for the latest news on Hajj. Inshallah, we will be there. And we are still waiting for your Hajj stories, your unique experiences. Coming on to our next story. Intelligence operatives are scrambling to seize two spy surveillance machines that can access bank transactions. This is absolutely astonishing. Spy machines that can access bank transactions and jam cell phone network signals. Now, the machines are believed to be the hands of private citizens who obtain them illegally. This is a story that I've covered on mainstream media. Now, the search for the prohibited instruments, which are used only by security agencies, has lasted for several months. These are according to sources. Now, a source familiar with the investigation says that the intelligence operatives have struggled to get information about the devices known as the grabber. So you would have seen it in newspapers, you would have heard it on mainstream media, you would have seen it in the Sunday Times and many other as well, including the Star. These things are called grabbers. They extract information. Now, people who have the grabbers really hide them, because they know it's illegal to have them. They also know criminals want to use them. They know they are risking being robbed by criminals or getting arrested. This is according to the source. Well, the disclosure comes a few weeks after the police confiscated a super spy machine, this particular grabber, from three men who were arrested at the Irini Village Mall in Centurion. An intelligence agent who want to remain anonymous explained how it works. And maybe something interesting, I was really fascinated with it. He explained how it works and the risk it poses to people. He says it could have listened to a conversation of the president, President Zuma, and any minister without anyone knowing it, and it's more powerful than the ones used by the state. A few weeks ago, Vali Lotter and two men were arrested after they were found in possession of the grabber. And this is an astonishing amount. It's worth 29 million rand. Now, the spying gadget, the grabber, which is custom made, can bug up to 10,000 cell phone lines and locate any person anywhere. Now, the powerful tool can also jam networks, download and intercept SMSs and MMSs to any number, and detect other surveillance devices and block them. Now, State Security Agency spokesperson Brian Dubé says it was working with other security agencies to investigate how private citizens managed to buy the grabber. We're going to be going for a break. After the break, we're going to be speaking about another story that's been making headlines, another story that I broke on mainstream media about the tragic deaths on South Africa's roads, particularly in Swaziland. Stay tuned to Perspective.
صرت في ظرف عصيب فاكشف البلوى فيا ربي أنا.
Welcome back to Perspective. My name is Faisal Patel. It's been a tragic weekend on South African and Swaziland's roads last weekend. More than 100 people have died in separate incidents in the Western Cape, in the Eastern Cape, KwaZulu-Natal and in Swaziland since Friday last week. In one incident alone, over 30 people died in a bus crash near Butterworth in the Eastern Cape. Now, with regards to Swaziland, while the Swaziland government is yet to release an exact death toll, it's been reported, and I reported on this, as many as 65 girls were killed when the open bed trucks they were being transported in collided with another car. So the truck collided into a car and another truck collided into their truck. 65 girls were killed. Now, the girls were on their way to the annual Reed Dance Festival in Swaziland. 36 people died in a bus crash on the R408 near Willowvale in the Eastern Cape on Saturday. In a separate incident, also in the Eastern Cape, at least 9 people were killed when the taxi they were traveling in overturned between Kreerok and Graaff-Reinet. And the bloodletting on the roads continued in the Western Cape, where 10 people died on the province's road. In KwaZulu-Natal, 2 people lost their lives in a collision in Glendale on Saturday. Now, the exact causes of the various tragedies are still under investigation. But with regards to the Swaziland accident, Swaziland has now officially says that only 13 girls died, but the Swaziland Solidarity Network says 65 people have died, and the Swaziland government and the kingdom is trying to cover these up. There's also outcry that while these girls had died, the king Mswati III failed to mourn the deaths of the girls, yet celebrated the Reed Dance. And for those that don't know, the Reed Dance is normally a festival or a celebration where the king normally chooses another wife. So absolute tragedy there as well. There was calls for 2 days of mourning. There was calls for the Reed Dance to be cancelled, but it wasn't cancelled. So absolute tragedy as well. Coming on to another story, we know that Eskom and load shedding has been plaguing the country, plaguing us. When you go home, your phone's batteries are flat, you can't cook, the children, you know, stuff in the fridge goes off. Well, you know, there's now new developments taking place. President Jacob Zuma has called on Eskom to move as quickly as possible to avoid any further delays in construction at the Madupi power station. Zuma officially opened the Unit 6 of the Madupi power station on Sunday. Like I mentioned, Unit 6 was officially launched in Lephalale in Limpopo on Sunday after it came into commercial operation last weekend, adding 800 megawatts to the national grid, which is quite a substantial amount as well. Now, Zuma says that the opening of the Madupi power station, or Unit 6, is an important milestone in achieving Eskom's growth forecast, which is about 4,800 megawatts capacity on the national grid. Now, Zuma also expressed concern that energy shortages in South Africa are hampering economic growth. Construction on the station, which consists of 6 units, began in 2007, and government hopes to finally complete it by 2017. Now, it's hoped the Madupi construction will grow the country's GDP by approximately 0.35% per year. But Zuma says the completion of one of the units shows that there is light at the end of the tunnel, which could make load shedding a thing of the past. And load shedding is disastrous. I mean, it's absolutely terrible. I know I have a tough time with it. When you go home, you know, after a long day, your iPad's battery is flat, your phone's battery is flat, you can't charge it, it's for a couple of hours, there's no electricity, your wife can't cook, you know, you've got children at home, they drink bottled water, bottled milk, and you need to warm these things, and it's just absolutely ridiculous. And then obviously generators as well, you know, some people cannot afford generators, and you rely on this. But thankfully, for close to now 26 days or 25 days, there's been no load shedding. And let us hope that it stays that way as well. Now, coming on to another story, and this is a story that I brought in because it was actually brought a little chuckle when I actually read it and when I actually processed it. An Egyptian muezzin has been suspended by authorities after being accused of intoning. Listen to this. An Egyptian muezzin has been suspended by authorities after being accused of intoning "Prayer is better than Facebook" in his early morning call for people to pray. So in other words, when he was giving the Fajr Adhan, instead of saying that Salah is better than sleep, he said it that Salah is better than Facebook. And this, I mean, it's something that really it amused me when I actually seen it. We didn't know actually it was true, and I do had to do some research to find out whether it was actually what was said. Now, the action was taken against Mahmoud al-Mughazi, who denies the charge after devout Muslims complained that he had altered the traditional call to prayer. We know that the Fajr Adhan is completely different to the normal Adhan because there's one extra line, As-salatu khayrun min an-nawm, which is Salat is better than sleep. And he went on to say that Salat is better than Facebook. But we'll expound on that in a few minutes. Now, villagers in Bahira province, north of Cairo, reported Mughazi to the Ministry of Awqaf, or Religious Affairs, charging that he replaced the usual prayer is better than sleep dawn call to the faithful prayer is better than Facebook. And a lot of people, people sit on their Twitter handle or sit on Facebook or on the internet right up until the early hours of the morning, and you completely forget about the Salah. Now, ministry officials Sabri Ebada told AFP that the incident happened on Saturday and confirmed that the muezzin had since been suspended. And she says the case will be referred to the prosecution service, which will see that the law is applied. Now, Mughazi appeared late on Sunday on a private TV channel, and he denounced the accusation as lies. He says it's absolute hogwash, it's not true, they are making up the stuff. And who he accused? He accused the opposition Muslim Brotherhood of being behind it, saying the group wanted to get him, the muezzin, out of the masjid for obstructing its activities. So let me know what your thoughts and comments are. We know that technology has taken prevalence in many homes across South Africa, especially Muslim homes and other homes as well. And sometimes when you get so engrossed in these games or in your internet, on Twitter, on Facebook, and many other activities as well, that sometimes we go into the early hours of the morning. Sometimes it's time for Salah, and we neglect our Salah by sitting on these devices, and maybe the muezzin became frustrated. He realized that the masjid is not as full as it hoped to be. It's empty. People are not coming for Salah, and it just drives you to frustration. And instead of giving the normal Fajr Azan, he actually went to say that Salat is better than Facebook. So a humorous but story there, and it's something that we need to take cognizance of, isn't it? That Salat is more important than anything, especially when it comes to social media and Facebook. Coming on to our tech segment, two of South Africa's major cell phone networks have warned that some of their customers may not be fully aware of how much data is being used by modern smartphones. Now, this comes after concerns were raised by cell phone users who claimed they were being charged for data which they did not use. Now, MTN and Vodacom say new technology connections like 4G or LTE mean more data is being used by these devices. Now, MTN's Eddie Moyes says in all of the cases they've investigated, they've never found any evidence of so-called data vanishing. And Vodacom's Yanni van Zyl says people underestimate how much data it takes to send even a single high-res photograph. Now, 5 megabyte photos are now the norm, and we upload 20 or 30, and then the data just disappears. Now, both service providers or cell phone networks warn that apps can be updated automatically, often requiring big chunks of data. MTN also aired it's about to launch a social media campaign to deal with these and other issues. So, and we in an age where now that we are relying more on data than SMSs and text messages and voice calls. And unfortunately, smart devices like these, iPhone, Samsung, tablets, whatever you call, you know, when you just download a simple message or picture, it takes a lot of data. So unfortunately, you know, these days, 500 megs, 200 megs is just too little. We need now up to 5-6 gigs. So just be careful when you do use your data, that you don't run depleted, or it's not depleted and you get charged additional charges. Unfortunately, we've come to the end of another edition of Perspective for this week. Remember, you can join me again next week, inshallah, when we discuss stories making headlines, not only locally, but nationally and internationally. And remember, again, I want to emphasize that, inshallah, we just, ITV's got a few weeks before the team departs for the holy lands of Mecca and Medina. We will be broadcasting live from there. So we're going to bring you a spectacular special on the Hajj this year, inshallah. And remember, I'm still waiting for your stories. Please do send us your unique Hajj experiences. Interact with us via social media, via Facebook, whatever the means is. Tell us how it is. If you've been for Hajj, your unique experiences, we really want to hear it. And inshallah, we will broadcast that on air and share that with our many, many thousands and millions of viewers. Like I mentioned, you are welcome to interact with me by sending me a mail on faisal@itvnetworks.tv, or drop me a tweet on @faizy143, or you can even comment on facebook.com/faisalpatel. From myself, Faisal Patel, and the great team here at ITV, fi amanillah, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
أناجي الحق في ليل بهيم أصدق النجوى وأدعو الله من قلب سليم يطلب التقوى. أناجي الحق في ليل بهيم أصدق النجوى وأدعو الله من قلب سليم يطلب التقوى. إلهي صرت في ظرف عصيب فاكشف البلوى، فيا ربي أنا عبد